Good morning, comrades. It's the one you've been waiting for. It's time for Watch Duke Die Over and Over Again for 2 hours, part 3. If you're watching this, you probably know that this is something you're interested in, so... okay. I mean, I wouldn't blame you for not being interested in it. I mean, in a way, what I'm doing is basically just a speedrun route. Except that I'm not actually going to speedrun the game. I'm trying to remember. I feel like this is the one that I cleared at the end of the last stream. Shouldn't I be up there closer to the top right? Or maybe, no, maybe this is a whole different room. Yeah, because I definitely don't remember this specific layout. Although it's, oh wait, no, is this the one where I have to... Yeah, I thought I was higher up. And then I... Yeah, I think it may not have auto-saved? Did I have to go to save and quit instead of just Xing out of the program? Yeah, this is like... This is the end of the last stream. Well, this is... extremely disappointing. At least I think so. I don't know. I'll have to get further into this area before I can tell for sure. So I flip myself around like that. Bounce myself up. Well, okay, so I have a save point here. Okay, yeah, this is different. I think. I don't know. Anyway, how are all of you? Happy Sunday. I have a weird sleep schedule. I work midnights, and then during the weekends, I try to get my sleep schedule flipped around a little bit, so I have more time during the day to do stuff, and sometimes I get my days mixed up, but this is definitely Sunday, September the 17th. 2017, so 9-17-17. All right, it's going to take me a little bit of time to get the feel for the game back again. Okay. All right, so yeah, this is definitely different. Okay, I'm just glad I didn't lose all that progress because it took me like an hour. So I need to... that, and then that. Okay. That wasn't nearly as bad as it looked. Oh wait, no, this is. Yeah. This is totally the thing I spent like an hour trying to do during the last stream. Because there's the popsicle wall. Well, this should be fun. Well, I did it once, so I know I can do it again, right? Right, so I have to shoot the rope straight down, flip myself around like that, and then somehow... Okay, see, I practically almost made it the first time. And I'm not on a time limit this time, so I don't have to limit myself to only 10 attempts like I did the last time. I mean, when you think about it, it's kind of incredible that I managed to complete this part in only 10 attempts. I don't know how I did it. Yeah, I mean, maybe it's my fault for not choosing save and quit. I thought there was an autosave. Maybe it only autosaves in the non-action-y zones? I'm not sure. I'm gonna have to figure out a different solution to archiving my videos rather than archive.org, because archive.org, even if you upload a video with no metadata, like I uploaded a video where the title and the file name were just a random string of letters, it still puts a bunch of similar videos, quote unquote, based on metadata at the bottom of the page. And on the one that I uploaded with no metadata, it's just a bunch of random stuff, and I have no idea if any of it is objectionable or not. I mean, it's not like, I don't know why I did that. It's not like when I had a David Duke radio show in the similar items. Mostly it's in other languages, so, but you know, I don't speak those languages, so who knows what those videos are about, right? But yeah, I just generated like a string of 20 random letters and numbers, so the odds of other videos having that exact same string of letters and numbers is, I mean, it's nil. So they've got to be just picking some random stuff and putting it on there, which I don't like. I mean, I know that on YouTube, at the end in the recommended videos, you can't control what shows up there either, but YouTube is kind of a, like, I feel like it's sort of expected on YouTube that there's just so much content that, you know, no one's going to see one of those suggested videos and assume that it has anything to do with my videos. I mean, sometimes it will, you know, sometimes it'll be other videos that I made or other videos of the same game. Sometimes it's just random stuff, or seemingly random stuff. And like, YouTube is, you know, it's a proprietary monopolistic platform, and you know, that's just part of the territory that it's going to show you other junk that you don't want to see. But on archive.org, I thought that they would do better than that, and I emailed them asking if it's possible to disable that feature, and they haven't gotten back to me. So yeah, very disappointed if I'm going to have to discontinue using archive.org. I mean, I know it's petty of me to complain, considering all of the free hosting, free bandwidth, free storage that they're offering, but it smacks to me of like, there we go. It smacks to me of like, archive.org, it feels like part of their mission statement should be letting people have more control over their content. And the fact that they don't give you that kind of control, it's a real bummer. So I might start using like Mega. With a free account, you can host up to 50 gigs of data. And with like, okay. So it's basically just the same thing again in reverse. You can host up to 50 gigs of data with like a terabyte of transfer per month with a free account, which is nice. That's not a permanent solution, but I could archive some of my stuff. And the reason I'm doing this whole archiving business is because YouTube increasingly makes it more and more difficult for people to download YouTube videos with software and plugins and Chrome add-ons, Firefox add-ons, because they want people to pay for that YouTube Red subscription, which, of course, it doesn't actually let you download the videos. It lets you, you know, save the videos in a format that's not accessible to you. And since my videos are Creative Commons, I want to have a resource where someone can just download the raw MP4 file with both audio tracks, the commentary and the no commentary, and subtitles if applicable. So they have that accessible to work with. And with YouTube, that's not really possible unless you do everything within the YouTube ecosystem. And I don't know why they even give you the option on YouTube to tag videos as Creative Commons if they don't allow people to download them and use them. That's like, that's antithetical to the Creative Commons philosophy. It's really just the same walled garden, just with a nice label on it. So yeah, I might start uploading to Mega. Is this going to be a boss fight? Seems like a big chamber. So yeah, the teleport button is disabled, so whatever this is, it's going to be a story segment. Well, I believe I will start on the left and then move to the right. I mean, the nice thing about archive.org is that it automatically generates a torrent file for whatever you upload, and it has like it auto seeds it on two computers, which is pretty handy. And I could just use that torrent file and point people to that, because it's way faster than downloading from archive.org anyway. But as long as that page is there with that stuff at the bottom, I'm not going to be comfortable with that. And maybe this is silly of me, maybe I'm overreacting, but it's something that bothers me. No! Man, I was close. Hey Tarka, welcome. Okay, so I wasn't in a story segment, it was just kind of an interstitial point where for whatever reason it didn't want me teleporting back to the previous save. All right, this seems doable. I just have to not lose my momentum here early on, which means doing two very quick horizontal grapples. Shoot. Totally see what they're going for here. It's all about the execution at this point. I mean, if I can just nail both of these perfectly, then that should be enough. But this is going to be very difficult in terms of like reaction times and stuff. Maybe I should jump across and then use like downward momentum. I wonder if that's a thing. Not really. Yeah, like I don't quite have enough time to launch the hook a second time. And if I just hit the second one straight away, then I just fall to the floor. Almost. Actually, I think even if I do hit it from here, from that point, I'm still just going to hit the floor and not keep my momentum going. Maybe if I hit this one diagonally while I'm falling, that might be better. Like that. Yeah, there we go. Oh, so close. Okay, yeah. There we go. Yep, that's what I needed to do. Oh, it's one of these, eh? I mean, this may be doable without using the grapple at all. Well, until I get to, like... But yeah, this looks like it's strictly a platforming puzzle. Although I can use my grappling hook to do it a little bit more quickly. Okay, so yeah, there's definitely going to be like a back and forth there down at the bottom. In some ways, this game reminds me of Explosion Man, which I really enjoyed when it was new. The first one, I never played Miss Explosion Man. Or was there Explosion Man 2 as well? I know there was at least one sequel that I didn't play because people said it was annoying. But yeah, I played the original Explosion Man with Moors and another friend, a three-player local co-op, and at the time it was like an extremely unique and kind of brilliant experience, like a co-op multiplayer puzzle platformer, but like not in the Lost Vikings sense. The puzzles were like, I mean, it was more like this, you know, you have one mechanic jumping, well, two mechanics. You have jumping and you have exploding, and all of the puzzles were based around like coordinating explosions with your friends and exploding off of each other in just the right ways to get enough angular momentum to get where you want to be. And I thought it was like extremely like innovative and really unique, and I thought, man, this Twisted Pixel company, they're going to go places. And then nothing else they did after that really caught on. Like, it seems like the thing they doubled down on was like the FMV, the silly FMV cutscenes. Which, I mean, I like that in Explosion Man. That was another interesting, unique thing. But, they're not enough to, you know, support a game on their own. Yes! Okay, so yeah, you don't really need the grappling hook for that one. I may have been overcomplicating it. I tend to do that. But yeah, the single mechanic puzzle platformer is a really interesting kind of underused genre. I mean, I like The Lost Vikings too, where you have the three mechanics that you have to, you know, you have to balance. But like games like this and VVVVVV, which I don't know if the stuff in VVV really, I would consider it puzzles, except for like a couple rooms. That's more about strict execution, but in Silver Grapple, I would definitely consider these rooms to be puzzles that you have to solve with physics, and that's something you don't really see a whole lot. I mean, even, you know, it doesn't have to be with physics, like, stuff like, Keylogger, which is an indie game by, his Twitter handle is Webbed Space. That's a good one. Old stuff like, oh man, what's that old NES game? with like the different keys that you have to. Solomon's key. Yeah, stuff like Solomon's key. I like stuff like that. Okay, so I'm going to want to. So close. Okay. I think that is what I want to do. First of all, just to get to that checkpoint. Doesn't look like there's going to be anything down. Like these springs, it looks like they're just there to help you back up. But okay. Yeah. It is just a pit of death, which you can see if you look at the map. Oh, that's cool. The electric fields actually move on the map as well. Okay, so I'm going to have to follow the diagonal path of the electricity, use this little area in the middle, and then swing down to the bottom right. Seems doable. Just gotta, you know, keep the momentum up. Which I'm not doing a very good job of yet. So I've been playing more West of Loathing. I am about 8 hours into it, which, from what I've heard, the game's not much longer than that. I probably have another 3 or 4 hours to go. Although I am playing with the hard hat, so my experience, you know, could be a little bit different than the people who's, you know, they play for 8 to 12 hours. The hard hat is a special hat you can equip in West of Loathing. Did I say Kingdom of Loathing? West of Loathing. And when you wear the hard hat, it permanently makes the game harder and you can never take it off. So that is a really kind of funny and interesting thing. Why am I having trouble hitting this? But yeah, I'm having a blast. It's one of the best RPGs I've ever played in terms of just player choice, like choosing how you want to handle things and, you know, playing it the way that you want. Yeah, that's true, Tarka. I mean, people use the search feature, or they use the related video stuff to kind of game the system and get views when they're not supposed to. Or not supposed to, but like, they game the search engine optimization to make their videos appear anywhere on the internet or anywhere else on YouTube. Which, you know, I think we've come to expect that as just a side effect of YouTube. And yeah, you're absolutely right. If I want total control over my stuff, then my only option is using my own platform. Yeah, I don't think I can touch the ground at all here. But, you know, archive.org, they are ostensibly dedicated to, like, kind of openness and freedom and, you know, the way, you know, the old vanguard of the internet, the, you know, free and open source software and liberation and, you know, the power to use the internet for the people, not for the corporations, which is why it surprises me that they do the similar videos thing at all, because they're a nonprofit and they are dedicated to, you know, giving everyone a platform. You know, as long as as long as you're okay with other people reusing or, you know, remixing your content. Which is, I mean, I guess that's kind of a contradiction because, like, I can't say that I'm allowing people to use my content the way they want, and yet say that I don't want archive.org to show the similar videos. Like, it's a, I mean, it is kind of a contradiction, but I would think that the philosophy of archive.org would, you know, would mean they would want to allow you that kind of option. I don't know. It's a whole mess. I wonder if I'll just, like, if I can start uploading my YouTube videos with no metadata. Just the title of everyone is just a random string of letters, but then they'll still show recommended videos based on, like, the history of the people who watch my videos. You know, people who watch this also watch this. And, you know, I'm not saying this is the worst thing in the world or anything, but, you know, I would just prefer it if that didn't happen. Well, apparently advertising is going to die. You know, internet advertising as a business is going to die in the next 5 to 10 years anyway, so we'll all be going back to just hosting text files on, like, college servers and stuff. At least that's what the advertising industry would have you believe, because the new version of iOS or Safari or whatever on the iPhones is going to prevent third-party cookie tracking after, like, a certain number of days, just across the board. And the advertisers are kind of moaning and groaning because, you know, this is going to disrupt their business model. And if you're cynical, then you would suspect that this is just because Apple is planning on getting in on the advertising business. You know, if you're less cynical, you might... Oh my god, okay. I feel like that shouldn't have worked, but it did. Then Apple is just trying to protect their consumers and protect their data and their privacy by putting these limitations in place, but, you know, Apple is not doing so great lately, at least in the, you know, the realm of public opinion. So they might be bracing themselves for new revenue sources. This whole thing is metal. Like, even... no, that's not metal. Yeah, exactly, Levant. Apple caring about consumers. So yeah, although they're... You know, this move might seem like... Might seem like a good thing, it almost certainly means that Apple is starting to... Is going to get into advertising, and they are shutting out their competitors. Or trying to. But yeah, the business models of the internet are going to change in quite a few ways over the next 5 to 10 years. And I'm interested in seeing what happens. Okay, so I... Oh, okay. Right, so I need to light up both of these. Okay. Like, I don't know why, but I feel like once I light up both of these, whatever's in this background here is, like, going to turn into a boss, even though I don't know if a boss fight for this game really makes sense. It kind of looks like some sort of squid. Like, you have the two eyes here, this is the squid's head, and then you have the tentacles over there on the left and right. I don't know. I suppose we'll see. So this appears to just be about, you know, not, I mean, there are probably people who, like, try to get through that as quickly as possible by using the rope and have to try over and over again when really all you have to do is not move that quickly. Oh, I see. Ooh, that's cool. extra momentum from the ice. This is a strange looking room. So I guess my goal is this thing over here on the center left. Which means I'm going to have to start from here. But what's all this stuff, like, above me? That's weird. So I'm going to have to, like, start over on the left and then just keep my momentum going. Oh, I see. So I should have enough momentum. Yeah, there we go. Okay. Neat. Well, if I do it correctly. I watched this really great video about how Steve Jobs is actually the person responsible for ruining Apple. It talked about the comparisons between the Apple Macintosh, the original one, and the Apple 2GS, which came out at about the same time. And the 2GS was just the superior computer in every way, well, almost every way. It didn't have, like, the processor wasn't as good. But that's not because of cost, that's because Apple deliberately, crippled the functionality of the 2GS processor because they didn't want it, like, cannibalizing their Macintosh sales, which is just absurd. And Steve Jobs was kind of the mastermind behind, well, he wasn't the mastermind, but he kind of took over the Macintosh project. And then he kind of made it so his own influence, like he made Apple focus more on the Macintosh than the 2GS. And the Macintosh costs, like, twice as much as the 2GS, even when you factor, you know, the price of a monitor, because the Macintosh had a built-in monitor, you had to buy one for the 2GS. But even when you buy a 2GS monitor, at the time, it still cost less than half the price of the Macintosh. Oh, weird. Okay, I get it. Yeah, so I'm going to have to backwards my momentum probably a couple times here. So yeah, the 2GS was actually a really good computer and competitive with the competitive with the 16-bit computers of the era, and the Macintosh was kind of a flop, at least the original one. And I think that's what caused Apple to kind of kick Steve Jobs to the curb for the first time. Well, I guess the only time. Like, they got rid of Steve Jobs for a little while. But then he came back in, like, the late 90s or early 2000s or something and turned Apple into the luxury, overpriced electronics manufacturer that they are now. So yeah, that was kind of the downfall of Apple right there, was the focus on... So I can't... Like, I can't give myself leftward momentum here because of that metal wall. But yeah, the video was by the 8-bit guy on YouTube, and I think the title is, like, Apple's and Steve Jobs' Greatest Mistakes Part 1. But unfortunately, he never made, like, a Part 2. Oh, I know what I have to do. Okay. So I'd like to see the continuation of that series. Yeah, I think Apple is, like, they still have this perception of being, like, this totally monolithic, innovative kind of technology company. But, like, the Apple, like, the iPhone X is, like, it's, you know, it's an overpriced thing that just copies the innovations that Android phones have been doing for years, and people are speculating that Apple is on its way out, which, you know, thank God. I used an iPhone for a little bit just to see what I was missing, because I had only used Android phones up to that point, and it was terrible. Like, even beyond the limitations that I knew about, like not being able to transfer files to it, not being able to expand the storage, not being able to replace the battery. Like, even knowing all that stuff, it was still a terrible phone. And I regret that purchase. But I'm back on Android. I have a Moto G5 now, which is about $200, and it's the best phone I've ever used. I can't picture myself ever needing another phone. It doesn't have a replaceable battery, that's the only thing. So, not sure, like, what the, like, not user replaceable anyway. I might be able to, like, send it in and have the battery replaced, but I'm not sure how that works. But, yeah, I don't need, like, it has a thumbprint scanner for some reason, which I don't need that. I don't need Face ID. I don't need animated emojis. Like, I don't need any of the stuff that because the way capitalism works is you have to consistently have growth, which means you have to constantly be doing new things, whether they're good or not. And we've reached the point where mobile phones are, you know, they're so good that there's nothing else that they can do with the current technology that we have. Like, obviously, they're not perfect, and people want, you know, phones with better battery life. They want phones with, I don't know, I'd say that's about it. Like, my ideal phone, I would say, would, I don't know, I think battery life is the only thing, because anything else I would do with a phone or with a pocket computer, I would just do on a laptop or a real computer anyway. So, yeah, Apple is, hello Optimus Prime Optimus, Apple is, they're a great marketing company. They are geniuses at advertising and getting their name out there and getting into the zeitgeist. And that's why all the technology magazines and shows and everything, they still cover Apple as though they're relevant. Which, in terms of actual usability of software, they're really not. Or usability of hardware. I hope this is what I'm supposed to be doing. I mean, it sure looks like it. Right, so from that checkpoint over on the right, I wasn't able to hit the springs on the left. So this is what I need to do to hit the springs on the left. Which I almost had it, but I also almost hit that checkpoint again, which would not have been good. Yeah, and that's the problem with capitalism. Eventually, you reach a point where the only things that you can do to a market that demands constant innovation and constant growth is either, you know, make the older stuff less functional or add new stuff that no one actually wants. And of course, you still have the, you know, the Apple enthusiasts out there who for some reason, are loyal to this brand, who convince themselves that, oh yeah, the face ID is a great idea. The animated emojis, wow, that's, you know, such an innovation, but it's, I don't think it's something that the average technology user really wants. I mean, definitely doesn't need, and doesn't want either. Alright, so I need to use my downward momentum here. Actually, I don't know what I need to do, like what my ultimate goal is. Because I fell down that shaft over there on the right. I guess I just need to get going really, really fast at the bottom there. So on the left-hand side, I can swing myself up onto that little platform, the one that's shaped kind of like a like an H on the left with the little notches there. So I just need to fall and then swing myself over to the left, get like an incredible amount of speed, and then swing myself up that way. So let's try it. And yeah, this is why capitalism is doomed to fail, because you reach a point of diminishing returns, and you reach a point of just market saturation, and the only way to deal with that is to make everything worse. And don't get me wrong, I mean, innovations, you know, phone innovations have come about under a capitalist system, which are very good. You know, pocket computers as they stand are very good, useful devices that make people's lives easier, and I appreciate them, but once they are perfected, or once they are, you know, once you reach peak technology there, what do you do? And capitalism demands a solution, and none of the solutions are good. Capitalism restarts itself by creating major conflicts, says Optimus Prime Optimus. Yeah, that is definitely one of the ways they deal with it. Okay. So yeah, I'm on the right track. Oops, jumped too soon there. But yeah, Steve Jobs was actually kind of a con man. Like, his big innovation was convincing people that the worst computer was actually good. And that's what he is. You know, that's why he made Apple a success. Not because of technology innovations, although technology innovation did happen during Steve Jobs, you know, his reign at Apple. But the thing that he did that made Apple the billion-dollar, multi-billion-dollar company that they are is good marketing. You know, good trickery. Like with the original iPod, the old 2001 model, it was not, you know, there were hard drive MP3 players and even flash MP3 players at the time that were much better than the iPod, but he had a sleek marketing campaign, he had a sleek design, and I don't know how much of this was actually, you know, dictated by Steve Jobs, but you know, the original iPod, it had a tiny speaker inside the device so that when you use the little click wheel thing, it made a clicking noise. Like, the device had no mechanical, oh my god, if I had just gone left, I probably would have made it. the device had no mechanical click at all. Like, it was, you know, it was basically the same kind of membrane technology that, you know, every other machine uses, except for like mechanical keyboards and stuff. But by putting that little speaker in there that makes that click, he convinced people, or he tricked people into thinking that the thing was more sturdy than it was. And I mean, I have no idea how well the original iPod actually holds up. You know, maybe it's fine, but that's just one of the examples of the ways that he manipulated people, basically. And the iPhone, it feels faster to use than an Android phone in some cases, because the home screen, like, okay, this is hard to explain. So it sort of creates a screenshot of the home screen. I don't know if it's technically exactly a screenshot, but it keeps that in like a special memory thing. So when you back out of an app and you go to the home screen, it hides the loading process of bringing the home screen back into memory by showing you that screenshot first. And then while it's doing the loading process, it has that screen up. So it takes the same amount of time as any Android phone, but because it shows you that screenshot, it feels like it doesn't take as long. And I'm sure I'm not explaining this as accurately as I could be, but that's the basic gist of it. So yeah, Apple has been really good at conning people for a long time, thanks to Steve Jobs. And they're continuing to con people by putting out this ridiculous $1,000 phone that is, you know, over-engineered and just a mess. Like, the iPhone X is just a mess of technology that no one cares about. And it's $1,000. Like, that's the hubris of that company is not to be underestimated. The iPhone X, it's $1,000, Levant. $1,000, which I don't know what that is in pounds or euro, but it's not going to be cheap. Oh, come on. This is the worst Mega Man timeline. Yeah, I mean, I don't know why they let Dr. Wily take over after Steve Jobs died. I mean, seems like a bad business decision to me. Yeah, I think I need to slingshot myself all the way at the left end of this passage. And I think it's trying to do it prematurely is what's messing me up. Oh, hang on, I need a drink of water. Yeah, like, you can buy a $200 Motorola Moto G5 or, you know, any other new-ish Android phone and do everything you could possibly want to do with a pocket computer and be fine. I mean, it doesn't run, you know, all the fancy games, but, you know, The kind of games that you want to play on a phone are, you know, they're the low-tech ones with a simple interface that you can pull out of your pocket and play for 5 minutes on the bus. You know, that's what a phone game should be. And the idea of, you know, playing Gears of War or something, I mean, that's obviously not going to be an iPhone game, but, you know, something of that scale on a phone, just feels kind of preposterous to me. Yeah, I mean, I've replaced my phone, let's see, 4 times over the last 10 years, which, I mean, that's still not great. I didn't need to replace my phone that many times, but, like, I wanted to at least try an iPhone and see what I was missing, and they had the iPhone CE, which is like the small model that's less expensive, and I wanted to give it a shot, and it's just as bad as I thought. Yeah, mobile version of GTA and Tomb Raider. Like, yeah, it does not make any sense to me. And they sell these hideous mobile controllers that are like an Xbox 360 controller with a cheap plastic clip stuck onto it. Which I guess is how people play those games, but then you have to lug that thing around with you, and who's gonna do that? I mean, who would do that rather than just buying like a Vita or a Switch or something? Oh god, is Skyrim on mobile too? That is like, that's absurd to me. I mean, I play games on my phone, but they're like, you know, small puzzle games and like RPGs that you can control with like a single, you know, button interface. Oh, Skyrim's not on mobile yet. Well, I mean, isn't the chip in the Switch used in a lot of Android stuff as well? Like the graphics chip? So if Skyrim's coming out on that, then I guess it's probably just a matter of time. You couldn't play this on a phone, that's for sure. Like, even if this was out on phones, you know, imagine playing this with like a virtual D-pad and buttons. Open mouth, angry shouting man demands you build a generic fantasy empire. Yep, I mean, that's the number one genre of game on phones. Oh, and, you know, don't forget the only reason this game exists is so rich idiots will pay thousands of dollars for microtransactions and upgrades. That's the, which, I mean, the two genres overlap a lot, but that's basically what it boils down to. But no, there have been good mobile games. There's Steven Universe Attack the Light, which is like a fun little RPG on iOS and Android. I think it's like $3. I recommend that one. There is Tennis, spelled T-N-N-S, which is like a breakout-style Pong game that's like designed for a touchscreen and has interesting physics, like you can curve the ball by moving the paddle, and it has like levels, like a finite number of specifically built levels for that model. It does have microtransactions. You can buy like power-ups and stuff, but you don't need to. I think that game is $2 or $3. And I enjoyed what I played of Alpha Bear, although it did get kind of, it did seem to reach a point where, okay, if you want to keep having fun with this, you're going to have to pay money. But you know, that was a free-to-play game, and that's to be expected. Ugh. Touchscreen technology that's like 10 years old and it makes the screen feel like a real button. I mean, I think every Android phone I've used has had that. I mean, it's just, they vibrate the screen when you touch it, right? Oh, I don't know if it like has the matrix of motors. Like I think it's just a general vibration when you touch the screen. I mean that sounds cool. I don't think it'll replace like a physical button for me, but it might be the next best thing. Like, are there any consumer devices that use that? Oh, isn't that what the Steam controller uses on its touchpad thing? Like, I know that they have multiple vibration motors in the Steam controller. So, like, it feels like you're pressing different parts of the... Feels like you're pressing different parts of the pad, but I mean that's why I wouldn't use a Steam controller either, because that's not a replacement for a D-pad and buttons. I mean, when it comes right down to it, the only peripherals or tools that I want to use to play a video game are either a mouse and keyboard or a D-pad and buttons. And in very rare cases, I'll play games that require the analog sticks. And yeah, I mean, I play touchscreen phones or touchscreen games on my phone because your phone is something that you always have with you, and it's convenient to just pull it out if you have a few moments to kill. But of course, if a game's available for phone or PC, I'm always going to choose the PC version. I mean, you're right, Levant. The six-button Genesis controller, which I'm using right now, is still my favorite controller. I wouldn't say it's perfect. I mean, I don't think anything's perfect, but like, this is the best feeling thing to play these kind of platformer games with that I've ever used. Despite my continued failure at this, you know, not the controller's fault. If I was a bad gamer, then I would blame the controller, but this is all me. A car's GPS multimedia center had the matrix and motor things. Well, that's cool. I wonder if the reason why it hasn't been put into phones yet is just because they can't get it compact enough. Because it seems like something that's built into a car, like a car console, they have a lot of room back there to put stuff. So maybe it just hasn't been miniaturized yet enough for phones. I mean, I would try it out. I would see how it feels. Yeah, I think I was on the wrong track with that slide all the way to the left idea, because the ice stops at a certain point before that. So I need to just time it right and get it on that side. Ugh. Add a stick or two on there? I mean, you could. I mean, I have enjoyed stick games, you know, I'm not that much of a curmudgeon, but in general, it's not the kind of gaming experience that I want. Yeah, you're right, I'm talking too much and not concentrating enough, but you know, talking to the chat is, I would say, 70% of the point of these streams. I should do like a picture-in-picture thing and just show a video of me playing a different game. So for these parts, you can just watch me play something else. The screen folded out and it was half an inch thick. Yeah. So I guess the technology's just not quite there yet for phones, but someday. I guess when I intro'd this as the watch Duke die over and over again stream, more accurately, it should be the Duke fails over and over again stream. Because I'm not dying, except for there. I'm just not getting the momentum right. For a little bit, I thought it would be kind of funny if I just never did a part 2 of a video again. And just every time I streamed or uploaded something, it was always just part 1. I thought that would be kind of funny. But with this game, I actually wanted to play it more. I mean, I want to play more Lords of Waterdeep as well. Super Mario Chronicles, that was kind of a joke thing. I'm not necessarily, you know, itching to play more of that. Although, I might. Should the moon strike me. Desert Golfing ASMR, that was a joke. What else? I mean, Sonic Mania, I just finished that whole game in one go, so no reason for an episode 2 there. Holographic-based interfaces and how that will change everything. I don't know, Optimus Prime Optimus. That does not sound intuitive to me, but, you know, of course, I'm very much, you know, of the age where I'm an outlier for this kind of stuff. Like, people who are younger than me, like, typing on a touchscreen to them feels more natural than typing on a keyboard, just because that's what they grew up with and they're just so used to it. Someone I work with, whenever we have downtime at work, which is pretty often, I work the midnight shift and it's not the busiest time of day, but I mean, we're allowed to use our computers to, you know, do whatever, basically, within reason, and we can use them to watch YouTube or Netflix or whatever during downtime at work. And one of my coworkers, whenever there's downtime, she just sits there in front of her computer using her phone, and I wonder if that's just because, like, is she using it for something that she can't do on a computer, or does it just feel more natural to her? And it's kind of hard for me to wrap my head around. So I paid, I think it was $40. Might not have been that much, but it wasn't cheap. For a program called Visor, V-Y-S-O-R. And what Visor does, oh my god. I had it, but I bounced off of the wall instead of falling in there. I was robbed. But what Visor does is it allows me to connect an Android phone to my computer, and it shows a, you know, it's screen mirroring, so anything that's on my phone shows up on my computer. But also, it lets me control my phone with a keyboard and mouse. So I have like a window up on my monitor of my Android screen, of my phone screen, and I can use it, you know, basically just like it was a computer. And there is a free version of Visor. I think it has some limitations that made me want to buy the full version, but it's a very good program. I haven't found anything else that works quite the same way. And the main reason I do that is because people like to text me. And I do have a Google Voice number, so I can use that to text people, but I would rather have, like, you know, a unified phone number. A phone number that, you know, one phone number that people know they can always reach me at. And with Visor, I can connect my phone to my computer, and I can send SMS messages on a keyboard. And, you know, it's plugged into my computer, so it keeps the phone charged and stuff. Maybe it is better to swing around on the left side. Yeah, you might be... If I had shot my grappling hook instead of just trying to sidle in there, then I would have made it. There's definitely a little bit of bounciness to the collision detection in this game that can be a little off-putting. And we had a good example of that during the last stream when I kept trying to hit that launch pad and I would just bounce off of it instead. But, as always, I did it once, I know I can do it again. I'm really glad I don't time myself during these, because I would really hate to see how long I've been trying to do this part. But yeah, for me, D-pad and buttons to play games, mouse and keyboard to control a computer. Like, I'm never going to, you know, get to a point where, oh, touchscreens are good enough, you know, I can just use this. I mean, there are people who have phones who don't have computers, which, I mean, I guess that makes sense, but, like, computers are so cheap now, it just blows my mind that anyone would just not have one. I mean, you can get a basic computer for, like, web browsing and email and chat and stuff and writing for, like, well, I mean, you can get a Raspberry Pi for, like, $5 now, right? Of course, that's not everything you need, you know, but, like, the basic guts of a computer are so incredibly cheap. Pathologic. Oh, yeah. I think I did purchase it at some point when it was on sale. I haven't taken a look at it yet. It seems interesting. Just climb up the rope. Little guy, or girl, or person. I will say this, I am definitely enjoying playing games blind again. Or, you know, streaming games I don't have prior experience with, because we get to discover them together. So, that could be a good game to try that on. Or try that with. But yeah, Visor, it's actually a Chrome extension, which is kind of weird, but you can use it for free. I think the limitation for not paying the license fee is you can't use it full screen, which I don't really need to do that. I think there was something else, but yeah, it's a good piece of software. So, for example, if you have a smartphone plan with unlimited data, but you don't want to, like, okay, so my plan with Verizon is I have unlimited data, but I can only tether for a certain amount of data per month. I think it's like 10 gigabytes or something, which is pretty good. I mean, for basic, you know, web surfing, email, you know, whatnot, 10 gigabytes should be more than enough, but I can just hook my phone up to my laptop by USB and just use my phone on my computer. The only downside is it doesn't pass audio through to your computer. So if I'm watching a video I have to plug headphones into my phone's headphone jack, and it could cause a little bit of lag between the video and the audio, but so far it hasn't been like a deal breaker. Hey, Project Fumika. Yes, we are discovering this icy force wing very thoroughly. I am okay, so this is my speedrun route. I'm practicing this part to do this as efficiently as possible for my speedrun. I mean, I could have finished this area, you know, an hour ago, obviously, but you know, I want to do it perfectly. I want to nail it for speedrunning purposes. So, yeah. Thank you all for watching my speedrun route of Silver Grapple. I think Silver Grapple might be a bad name for a video game. Like, I feel like it's a little generic and kind of word salad-y. Like, it doesn't really tell people what the game actually is, which... You know, I don't have a better name in mind. But I think that might be one of the reasons it's not getting much traction. And I mean, the first time I saw like screenshots of this game on itch, you know, I was ready to dismiss it as just another pixel platformer. But when I actually watched the video, it convinced me to pick it up. Which the video, the trailer, featured it featured someone who's a lot better at this game than I am, so the swinging looked a lot more fluid. Oh, thank God. And the video didn't really get across the repetitive trial and error nature of this game. So if I wasn't okay with that kind of gameplay, then I might be a little peeved, but I enjoy it for some reason. Alright, Wall Squid, do your worst. Oh man, I have to go inside the squid? Oh, it's all metal inside, too. Every grappling hooker's worst nightmare. Broken monitors illuminate the room. Yeah, this is menacing. Actually, a couple of the containers are broken. So this is going to be like some sort of... Three of the containers. So this is like some sort of alien containment chamber. And there's going to be creepy biological life forms running around. Oh, is this guy? What's his name? Sylvian? Sylvan? Wow, you really have a knack for finding me, don't you? I hope you didn't put yourself in harm's way on my behalf. Let's get back then. I have what I came for. Stop, Sylvian. Damn, I knew I'd find you here. Hand over the ampule. No, this is my life's work. I can finally finish it. Too dangerous. It must be destroyed. No, you can't. You owe your life to me. Oh, shit. No, damn it. Wow, you're in bad shape. Come on, let's get you out of here. That guy shot me. I'm glad to see you're okay. I thought I'd lost you back on level 6 when the quakes hit. So this is the guy from the beginning of the game that I was, like, doing stuff in the warehouse for. I'm sorry to say, but Sylvian hurt you pretty badly. He got away, too. He's currently in possession of a very dangerous substance that was meant to be safely contained in cold storage. After the quakes hit, I went to try and destroy it. This facility is no longer fit to contain anything. Clearly, Sylvian beat me to it. I'm going to try and track him down. It would be a disaster if he tried to leave with it. Yeah, I think I predicted, like, 2 hours ago that Sylvian would betray me, so... I mean, not that... That's a difficult prediction to make. There's a teleporter just outside. When you feel up to it, you should track down Rana, and your friends. They helped me find you in cold storage. They'll be much safer if you bring them here. I want to travel through the water treatment facility and cut Sylvian off. He should be making for his lab now. Please get some rest. I'll be back soon. So yeah, I haven't seen Rana and... Rana and Victoria in a while. I never found volume 1 of this journal. I hope I didn't miss it, like, permanently. Still only have 2 volumes of this one. Oh yeah, and Luca, he was there too. Luca, Rana, and Victoria. An old hospital bed. You've left an impression on the mattress. Well, hopefully it thinks highly of me. It's a polished sink. You could almost see yourself in it. It's an empty shelf. It's another empty shelf. There's a board hanging off the end of the bed. Patient Faust K injured in a lab accident. The bed is covered in black stains. Ew. I don't think I know who K Faust is. The door is locked firmly. There's a card reader beneath the handle. Oh, so I have my grappling hook. And my grappling ability. Oh, am I still inside the weird alien spacecraft thing? Text illuminates the screen. Where are you, Zach? I can't take this any longer, says C. Zach says, I know, I'm so sorry. I'll get the doors open as soon as I find the key cards. Something's come up, you'll have to sit tight for a little longer. Zach, what? Zach? Zach? Nothing in the trash can. Right, so that's the teleporter that my friend was talking about. I don't remember his name, unfortunately. Okay, so that opens this little hatch for 2 seconds. So in order to access that, I'm going to need something else. We have a non-working launch pad here. You try to pull it, but the lever won't budge. Okay. So, do not have the tools to explore anything in this part of wherever this is. So, let's go through the teleporter. Okay. Well, I guess let's go back to the excavation site and see if my friends have returned. They might have just abandoned this area, though. Interesting. So, I might want to... Hold on. Oh, hospital. Okay. I wasn't sure where this area was. For some reason, I thought it would be at the bottom. Okay, so I have to find a key card to get through this door in the hospital. Interesting. Well, I'm actually not sure what to do next, then. I mean, I can teleport anywhere I've been previously, but there doesn't seem to be any indication of what I need to do to progress. Let me just make sure there's nothing I can do over here. Because this is the obvious place. Oh, you know what? Doi. Black key card. There you go. It's a little different from the others. Where could you use it? Well, I think I know exactly where to use it. The door is now unlocked and open. Diagrams and reports are spread across the desk. Complicated notes and symbols fill the whiteboard. You try and find a part you can read. The substance has shown the ability to reconstruct tissue and divide itself through mitosis. If we could refine this, the benefits it could provide are endless. On the other hand, we can't yet control how it does this despite every test we've done. In an unrefined state, the substance is toxic, caustic, and fatally dangerous. Well, that's the worst kind of dangerous. If not contained, there's a danger it could spread like a contagion. We must never allow it to be used this way. I believe it's too dangerous for us to keep in the current form. Should there be a breach of any kind, it must be destroyed. Okay. The plot thickens. Someone added a bunch of starch to this plot, because it is thickening right the heck up. The large door is securely locked. It looks like it requires a key card to open. Another key card. Dead end. Well, maybe this little bit of exposition will trigger something else. So the black stains, I guess, are the substance, the contagion. All right, that's the same. So I need a red key card. I thought I had one of those. Nope, just green and black. I think I saw another. I saw another red keycard door somewhere. Whenever you play this game, it gives you the thing vibe. Yeah, I can kind of see that. I haven't watched the thing, but I know kind of the stuff about it. The things. I wonder if this switch controls anything else. Or if it's just that. But yeah, the whole I don't know who to trust kind of vibe. So all that was down here. Oh, I have an idea. Well, that's not going to work, though, because I need to teleport to this one to fall down this shaft. I was going to press the switch down there and then try to teleport back to this save point and see if I can fall down the other area. If the switch releases that other hatch, which I can't even really verify, but yeah, that's not possible right now either. Okay, so we have one of those old-fashioned exploration mysteries on our hands. Well, I guess let's go back and revisit some of the previous areas and see if anything's different now. Like, I don't want to redo any of the action segments. I don't think that's going to take me anywhere useful. But if I just teleport to every location and see if there's anything new here. Oh, hey. It's, Rana. Hi, Rana. Hey, you're back. What happened? I could ask you the same thing. A researcher named Zach passed through not long ago. He said he was looking for Sylvian. Apparently, Sylvian was just using us to get deeper into the labs. Pretty ridiculous, isn't it? How about you then? Did you find an exit or another teleporter? Well, you see, blah blah blah. Oh, fantastic. I guess we should all move on then. Luca and Lee haven't come back yet. Could you please go and look for them? I'll go get Victoria and we'll head off. Right, Luca and Lee. Lee was the other one. You've done a great job, thanks. Oh, you're welcome. Happy to help. Oh, before I forget, in case you ever need to get down to level 7, it's not much, but maybe you'll find something useful down there. So I received a small key. Copper key given to you by Ronald Rutherford. Boiler key. And that's a bunch of boiler key. That sounds like, I don't know, like malarkey or something. One of those old-fashioned words for BS. Don't give me that boiler key. Alright, so on a hunt for my missing companions now. I'm going to try my just go to every teleporter plan and see if hopefully I can find them there. I mean, who knows what they're off doing? They're in their own little worlds. Well, actually, I probably just need to go to level 7 now that I have a key there. I have no idea where the entrance for that is. At the base of the pylon, maybe? Yeah, this takes me into another danger zone. Oh, here we go. There's a journal lying near the door. Volume 2 of Rana's journal. Yep, that's the last one for her. Victoria and I have just finished installing the new module on level 7. I find it frustrating how little we were told about it, save for its installation near cold storage and the litany of safety precautions we were forced to undergo. When the new employees get here, I hope that we'll no longer have to implement these tedious installations. At least Victoria has been here to help me. I have just learned the purpose of last week's installation. I can't stand for such a perilous environment, especially not when my coworker is put in this position with me. You don't have to expect our month notice. We're evacuating. Ooh, damn. You can take this job and shove it. Yeah, it's definitely some misapplication of science going on here. All right. Look at that. Only 3 check marks to go up there. Oh, you know what? That's how many teleporters. That little symbol up at the top right. That's the same symbol that's on the teleporter thing. Okay. So 3 more teleporters to find. I don't know why I didn't realize that before. Seems so obvious in hindsight. Well, it would help if I just shot my dang grappling hook down instead of diagonally. I'm British now, that's how I say diagonally. Oh. I guess I'm not safe there. Well, I'm safe from the one on the right, but not the one on the left. See, this little, like, the little bit of friction you have there when you bump up against a surface is not, it doesn't feel good. Everything about the grappling hook feels good, but the part where you actually interact with physical features of the level. Alright, so I think what I have to do is swing down this way so I still have momentum there. Because I don't think this is going to be possible to do on foot. I like this music. It sounds like a... like, kind of an electropunk take on, like, the Super Mario Brothers underground music. It would help if I know. Well, I guess I can just look at my map to see what that laser does. Okay, so I need to get in there before that laser does, because there's no point. Man, and then there's like extra death down at the bottom. Alright, this is gonna have to be a spectacular feat of some sort. It would be kind of nice if it reset the lasers. Whoa! I don't know how I did that. Oh, I know how I did that. There's like a split second there where the top laser is blocked by that. Okay. I just did it by accident. Oh boy, that is not a big window. I could be overcomplicating this as well. Maybe that's all I need to do. But you know, you see these carefully placed environmental elements, and you know, the instinct is to think that you need to use them. Let me try the easy thing before I try the impossibly hard thing. Yeah, I don't think the easy thing is going to work. You can do this the easy way, or the correct way. Oh no! Oh, but there's spikes, right. The extra death, okay. I stand corrected. So there's a laser down there as well. Which I'm still not sure how I'm going to get past, because I haven't really had a chance to get a good look at it. I mean, it would help if I could not die to the spikes. Okay, so that laser oscillates. Blue laser is good, red laser is bad. That's the way of the world. Holds true in G.I. Joe, holds true in Cheat Commandos, and holds true here. Oh no, in Cheat Commandos it's the other way around. Blue laser are the bad guys. Man, I didn't realize how subversive that series was. The blue lasers are the bad guys. Maybe it would be easier if I used the split second to just fall, instead of trying to grapple my way down. I mean, it's still a split second though, so... yeah, I don't know if it's necessary or helpful. Yeah, because either way I still have basically the same amount of time. Yeah, there's not really a whole lot to grapple onto down below. Maybe I should... yeah, you can't pause it without hovering the screen, so I can't really take a good look at my surroundings there. Yeah. It looks like I can shoot my rope straight up, maybe? It looks... yeah, there's a little bit to hold onto there. So, I can do that. Okay. Excellent. Alright. We have ourselves a good old-fashioned, one of these. Okay, so I cannot swing that way. A deceptively simple area. You know, the other checkpoint is right there. Just go to it. But, things don't always work out the way you want. I feel like I'm missing something. Like a key mechanic. If this was worms, then as soon as I let go of the rope, I would automatically be facing the other way. So I can sort of hook onto that thing in the corner there. I can almost, like, anchor my rope there. Wait, can I just, like, maybe get on the very, very edge of this, grapple, and then fall off? Is there, like, a tiny little bit of give there? Or do I just... okay. Yeah, I think I'm overcomplicating this again. Yep, I was. Oh boy. No, there's nothing to make a video game feel like a video game, like some good old-fashioned high-speed moving lasers. It's weird how sometimes the lasers are blocked by the environment, and sometimes they aren't. I guess it's not weird. I mean, it's a video game, but it makes it a little bit less intuitive than... Oh, hey, look at that. I think I just, like, skipped a segment there. I don't know. Okay. So here we have your classic 360 loopback. Haven't seen this in a while. Might be my favorite track in the game yet. I like how minimal and sort of understated it is. Ooh, fancy. I probably could have just held left there and made it, but I was struck dumb by the mechanics there. All right, door number 1, 2, 3, or 4. Okay, no buttons light up on the elevator. Right, these doors are locked. Okay, so I'm going to have to connect some sort of circuit in each of these rooms. Oh no. Still no red key card. Okay. Well, look at that. That's not very good security, guys. Putting the key in the next room. A sleek-looking monitor sits on the desk. Oh, that's it. Numerous files are stacked on the desk. A high-backed chair sits behind the desk. I wonder if this is Sylvian's office. There's a lab coat on the coat rack. Oh. Sorry about that, everyone. The little lever for my chair that determines whether it leans back or I can lean back against it popped loose, which it does from time to time. It's too dark to see, but you feel something while you fumble around. You found volume 1 of the Bloodstained Journal. Oh. Alright, I can actually read this now. I wonder if I was supposed to read volumes 2 and 3 first, and then when I get volume 1, it's like some sort of big revelation. Today I'm tasked with the activation of the new module on level 7. The module was a failsafe to guard against contamination in the facility, likely a response to the quarantine incident. When a dangerous contaminant is detected, the device will bury the facility underground to prevent a contamination from spreading. I've been assigned a partner to make sure nothing goes wrong. We're heading down soon. I have been sabotaged. So the big twist happens in volume 2. Volume 1 doesn't really have that much information. Except, you know, about the new module. I've been sabotaged. The person I was sent to level 7 with was an imposter. Before the device was engaged, he attacked me and damaged the machine. I was able to use my emergency return belt to make it to a teleporter. Good thing, too, the quakes that followed would have surely deactivated them. I realize I'm too wounded to carry on. I assume the quakes have caused some inconvenience, but if anyone finds this, you must know. The facility could crumble at any moment. Oh, good. Collect as many people as you can and find an emergency elevator out of this facility. I use this belt to escape that madman. Hopefully it can help you too. Ooh, a belt. Wait. I already have the belt. It's the emergency return belt. Okay. I was like, all right, new item, but yeah, then I remembered, oh. So that whole thing was just to find the other volume of the journal, A. All right, still can't access these doors, still can't call the elevator. going for an hour 45. I'll go a little bit more. Apparently this game has multiple endings. One way only. Well, I guess I want to go... Well, I have the red key card now, right? And there was another red door back in the hospital. Yeah. So I guess I should go back there. Oh, can only be used somewhere on the 7th floor. I mean, I guess it doesn't matter where I go. I just won't be able to get back here, but I'm pretty sure there's nothing else here. I checked it pretty thoroughly. Hey! It's you guys! There was a disaster here a while back. I would hate to think what would happen if it was repeated. The employee safety is paramount. If management cared about us, we'd be out by now. Boy. Too true. It looked like there was something else there I could inspect. So I wonder if Kay Faust is the one who wrote the Bloodstained Journal. I have a key card. A red key card. I like these, like, the build up on the elevator and, like, the high speed thing. That's really. You know, it's like the. It's like a hyperloop. Anything new on computer.tv? Let's see if I can activate these switches now. Nope. Levers. Whatever. I wonder what this is. Oh, I guess that's like one of those electricity fields, but it's been deactivated. Maybe I should go back to the boiler room and see if there's anything I missed down there. Was this door? Yeah, this door was open before. By the way, let me know if there's like a lot of wind. It's starting to warm up in here, so I had to point the fan a little bit more in my direction. I have it on low, so hopefully it's not causing too much noisiness. Okay, that's just that's that whole area. Boom. I wish elevators worked like that in real life. I mean, I guess some of them do. They're just not people elevators. Oh, Project Fumika doesn't hear the fan. Okay, good. Alright, well, where else have I not been recently? Base of the Pylon. I mean, I guess I was here recently, but not super recently. This looks suspicious somehow. Like, I wonder if it's possible to have like a lot of momentum and then sling myself up on top of this, like this glass bridge thing. I don't know if it would accomplish much, but I'm still, oh, so I lose my momentum between screens anyway, so I can just retry here. Yeah, there's like a little, well, not a little, but there's a surface I can grapple onto here and maybe fling myself up. I don't know. Well, if I push the D-pad up, I wish there was a checkpoint here so I could just teleport back when I retry instead of having to hoof it. I might be mistaken that this is enough momentum to get up there, but I mean, why would that big opening be there on the map if there wasn't some reason to do this? Know what I'm saying? Well, I can maybe fling myself over there, but then at that point I wouldn't have anywhere to go. I mean, not that I would have anywhere to go in the other case either. Let me try flinging myself the other way again. Yeah, I don't have enough momentum for that. Or I'm not going to. Yeah, okay. This is a red herring, I think. Yeah, I wanted to come back here and just see if there's anything I missed. I like that it doesn't hold your hand through the entire game. I mean, not that that would be a huge problem with this kind of game, since it's mostly about action and reflexes anyway. Yeah, that just starts this whole thing again. But I'm glad there are parts where you have to think a little bit to figure out what to do. Alright, so was there anywhere else I needed a red key card? The door that I thought I needed it for is a different kind of key card. Like, I feel almost certain that there was another point where it said I needed a red key card to open a door. But where? I mean, in the description for the item, it says it only works on level 7. Okay, so that door's still locked. this point, I'm just trying anything I haven't already tried. Or anything I haven't been able to do. Such as this, the security area over here. Which I don't think, I still don't. Well, that's a solid thing anyway. I won't be able to go in there unless I break something. Yeah, so this starts a whole action sequence. So for right now, I'm making the assumption that I don't have to redo any of the action sequences. That all of the backtracking is going to be in the exposition zones. Which level was the room I've been treated? There was a door requiring a key card next to the bed. Yeah, that was the black key card in the hospital. Oh, 7 swift transfer system. Maybe I do need to do this. Yeah, the hospital. I got the black key card, and the only thing I really got out of it was some exposition and the red key card. Unless there was another. Another red door that I was forgetting about. I feel a little iffy about redoing this, but this is level 7, and the key card says it works on level 7, so let's give it a shot. I don't actually remember if I was able to get through this area before, so this might be what I need to do. Alright, so I'm going to need a lot more momentum. If I want to... God, is that even possible? Doesn't look possible. Yeah, I might have just given up here because I didn't know how to progress. Yeah, these fans don't give you a whole lot of up momentum. Yeah, I don't think this is what I need to do yet. So, okay, here's my theory. This green stuff down at the bottom looks like some sort of liquid that can be drained. And it looks like underneath that, there's like an area where I can potentially shoot out of. So maybe that's what I need to do. So it looks like all of these elevators go to level 7, which is good to know. I mean, I did have this information. 7 swift. Okay. So basically all I need to do is anywhere there's one of those glass elevators, I need to see if there's a red door I haven't been in yet. Because that's always going to take me to level 7. Alright, let me just double check the hospital. I don't even know where the hospital is in relation to everything else. Yeah, so that was the black key card door. So yeah, this is level 7, right? Because the elevator brought me here. It can only be used somewhere on the 7th floor. So I guess I need a different red key card? I'm not sure. Curiouser and curiouser. All right, let's try going back to like the cold storage area. See if anything new's opened up there. I mean, this would be a totally acceptable game even if it was just a series of the challenge rooms with story between them. But the fact that you have a little bit of exposition or a little bit of exploration there makes things a little bit more interesting. So this is just this again. So if I go through here, I will have to manually teleport back now. Yeah, nothing else of note over here. So yeah, this is just tutorializing the speed system. Yeah, I keep treating this area as like a base of operations, but I guess we've sort of moved on from here at this point. Okay, well, I have my theory about like draining the water or draining the liquid and progressing from there. So maybe it has something to do with water treatment. Have I actually been here? Like, I remember seeing water treatment on my options list for the elevator. But I'm not... I mean, I must have been here, right? Well, if I was here, I missed this. You found the hydrofoil. While traveling at speed, these will allow you to run on water. You can drop below the surface by pressing down. Okay. Cool. So yeah, I guess I haven't explored this area. Oh, look at that. But I can't just... You know, I have to build up a little momentum. You know, I can't just... When it says at speed, that means above walking speed. Okay. Cool. Neat. Can you surf on the green asset as well? That's a good question. That might be my eventual goal here. Oh. Not sure what the point of all that was. Warning, the area beyond is flooded. For your safety, do not enter unless you are equipped with a turbine pack and an oxygen tank. I mean, who am I to listen to warnings, right? Holy crap. That is a large shaft. Okay, so I need to get some momentum and burst through that wall there somehow. Okay, so anywhere I can grapple onto has like the pebbled look instead of those pipes. Alright. Well, that wasn't water surfing, you dork. Neither was that. Who taught you how to water ski? The Pope? I bet he's bad at water skiing. Is the basis of that insult. Oh, really? I thought I was going to use that momentum for something. Oh well. So yeah, so far every single upgrade that you get, quote unquote upgrade, is just another way to gain horizontal momentum. Oops, I didn't have to do that. Because there was a speed pad thing, or the speed chip, and then there was this. And then I guess there was ice, but that's not really an upgrade. That's just an environmental thing. Oh, come on, why? I don't know why I keep falling off the edge like that. Like, I'm overcompensating for something, but I don't know what. Alright. Alright. I feel a bit like I'm going around in circles. As crazy as that sounds. What's the point of this room? Does it have a point? Oh, this is a different giant vertical shaft than the other one. Because the other one didn't have this door in the middle. Okay. Yeah, there's stuff I haven't explored over here. So there's like a tiny little... No, that's not a surface. So yeah, these action zones are starting to open up a little bit. And it wouldn't be so bad, except any time that you're not grappling, or not able to grapple, your movement speed is just so slow, it makes it a little challenging to sort of backtrack into these. Like, I feel like I need to... Like, I feel like I need to plug myself into that bottom left corner of this area. Because on the map... Well, I guess I have explored that stuff. So the only thing I haven't really looked into is this little bit here. But there's a switch there. Maybe it fills in stuff on the map even if you didn't necessarily step there. But if you... like, if you're in the same general area as it. Is the stream stuttering for anyone else? Let's see. Well, I only have 48 dropped frames for the whole stream, which is 0%, so hopefully it's not a problem on my end. Maybe a problem on YouTube's end, or just an internet connection issue. Wait. Okay, so yeah, here's my mistake, is that every time I look at the map, anything that's filled in is like, oh, I've been there. But it fills stuff in based on if you've, like, if you enter that section of the screen, not necessarily if you've physically stepped there. You know what I mean? Alright, so no way to build up momentum here. There's something shiny on this pewter box. Okay, so I need to somehow ski across this water instead of falling into it. Oh wait. Oh. Oh, this is going to be an actual thing that you have to, you have to get through without drowning. Maybe this is why the sign said I need an oxygen tank and the other thing. Yeah, I'm not going to be able to get through there without drowning. What about the other way? We have a shiny. A book is floating around the desk. You found volume 1 of the soaked journal. I like how your countdown meter doesn't pause while it's giving you that information. Soaked journal. Oh, is it a person named Soaked? Because it actually has a picture of someone. Alright, later, Sharka. Thanks for watching. Wow, this one has 7 volumes. No work today either. Ugh, I'm so bored. Helpful. Alright, let's try something kind of dumb here. Okay. So nothing seems to be able to give me enough horizontal momentum to start skiing here. At least not without hitting the wall first. Alright, am I sure I can't make this jump? Pretty sure. Yeah. So I have a need for speed. Okay, so it can't possibly be asking me to swim this, right? There's no way to, like, swim faster. I can only swim up. I can't, like, use my grappling hook, you know, aim it backwards and build momentum off of that. Alright, let's get as close to this side as possible. Yeah, there's no way this is what they want me to do. Is there anything over here that I missed? Oh, I never actually looked at this computer, did I? It's been flooded. Okay, well, it's a stool. You don't feel like sitting down. Oh, that's pretty good. There's no, like, other source of air down here. There's no, like, air bubble or anything. I mean, that's just gonna suck having to swim through regardless, whether I have to worry about drowning or not. Feels like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles on the NES, with all the underground electricity. Except that you die immediately. Or underwater, not underground. Fudge. Like, I feel like that sign was a warning for me not to do this. But at the same time, it feels like defying what this game asks you to do seems to be a recurring theme. Like, if I can actually make it through this, there might be, like, a pocket of air over here or something. This is the kind of trial and error I don't care for. I mean, that might be what I need the motivator thing for, because it said that you need an oxygen tank and a motivator. So maybe with the motivator, or whatever it was called, I can swim, you know, horizontally and actually make it through there. Okay, let's try something else. I'll be back for you, sparkly computer. I wasn't sure whether to say shiny or sparkly, so I said sparkly. Alright, so this brings me back here where... I couldn't remember what the last teleporter I interacted with was. Alright, so I've done this. I just get enough horizontal momentum to make that jump. Because it gives you something to grapple onto here. Right? Yeah, this is that first long vertical shaft. So I just use these to bounce up here, build up momentum like that, and then jump right at the end there. Okay. So I've done that part. Let me just double check. Make sure there's nothing of value down here at the bottom. No sparkly things like volume 2 of the journal or anything that I need. Nope, there's not. Okay. Oh, maybe. Weird. Oh yeah, I have not been here, and this is a section where I will definitely need the ability to breathe underwater. At least I'm pretty sure. It does not look like I will have enough time to get up there, although maybe I will. Maybe it's one of those, you can only make it there by the skin of your teeth kind of thing. Yeah, whatever this is, I can't do it yet. And I know I've said that before, and it turns out I was able to do it. But I can't picture. I mean, there's nothing I can do there that would help. You know, that would give me more time, or make me go faster, or anything. Oh, here's a shiny. Volume 4 of the Soaked Journal. Three panels with varying symbols plate the wall. There appears to be a passage behind them, but the panels block your way. Okay. There's also a different symbol. Or did it say that? Yeah, three panels with varying symbols. Okay. Interesting. No, I don't want to install Windows or install updates Windows. Fuck off. Okay, so here we have one-way currents. Like, if I could just quickly dive to the bottom of this might be something I could do. Yeah, I feel like the warning about needing equipment was to be taken seriously. Well, maybe not. Maybe that equipment is down here. I just, there's just a specific way you have to go about navigating this area to get it. Wasn't expecting that. Right. Okay. Seem to have a real problem aiming the grappling hook straight up. And that's a psychological problem, not a controller problem. Oh, okay. Wait. Yeah, this is something I haven't done. Too many of these areas look similar to each other. Right, I'm on the other side of that. Okay. Alright, well this is new. Whee! Nope. Well, I should probably see what's to the right. Oh, the source of the water. Well, not the source. The source of the water on this level, anyway. Okay, that was not as hard as I thought it was going to be. But I just circled around. Oh man. Okay, yeah, I did just circle around. So I need to go up the middle here. But there didn't seem to be any way to go about doing that. Okay, so that's just a bottomless pit. I fell down that. Yeah, a bit more visual clues as to the direction you need to go would be a little helpful. Okay. So yeah, I went the wrong way. I mean, I know I should have been paying more attention, but also everything looks kind of similar, so. Alright, so I need to hit those, or maybe not, I don't know. I need to hit those, but keep my water skiing momentum, like that. There we go. Yeah, like, these levels are turning into, like, mazes, which is pretty cool. I mean, I know that I'm getting frustrated by not knowing where to go, but it's not like I'm spending forever figuring out where I need to go. You know, I'm able to suss it out pretty quickly. Alright, need more speed there. I need more speed, the 1996 movie starring Keanu Reeves. That was Keanu Reeves, right? Or am I thinking of someone else? Am I thinking of another 90s guy? Nicolas Cage? I always get those two mixed up, even though they're nothing alike, just because they were both in a lot of movies in the 90s. I mean, for one, Nicolas Cage can actually act. Some might say that Nicolas Cage acts too much, but some might say that's what makes him great. I would say that. Oh no! Yeah, like, I can see when I'm going to screw up, because, you know, there's an exposed wall there, so obviously that means I have to grapple onto it. But sometimes your brain just doesn't make those calculations fast enough. Nice. Slid Beneath the Large Tank is a small book. Volume 5 of the Soaked Journal. So I have 1, 4, and 5. Yeah, I don't know what the point of having me find these books out of order is, because I'm not going to read them until I have all of them. Seems like kind of a strange design decision. Hey! Loot! Turbine pack! Oh yeah! Jumping underwater will make you swim much faster. Hell yeah! That's what I wanted all along. But I guess I have to hold the direction, maybe? Oh, I see. Okay. I thought it said, like, jumping into the water, but it meant pressing the jump button so I can get through these current areas. Hang ten, man! So, there must be something down here. Because why else put a giant reservoir of water right after I get the turbine pack, right? Or maybe not. Maybe not. Oh, you can just hold it. Okay, that's a relief. I could make a very rude noise for what I'm doing right now, but I will abstain, because I'm a gentleman. It seems like a weird area. Like, it's not even... I don't know. Like, there's not really a challenge there. You could just swim across if you wanted to. Okay, so now that I have the turbine pack, I can do that. The thing where it had all of the spikes that I had to swim through. Oh, okay. So that's where that leads. It's all coming full circle. Okay, so now I have to swing my way back across here. Yeah, like, just, I don't know, like, something over on the right-hand side, some visual cue to make me say, oh, that's a direction I need to go. Because obviously I can tell while I'm looking at my map, but when I'm not, you know, there's nothing drawing your eye in this direction, whereas here you have, like, the different colored background. So, just a suggestion. Listen to me, everyone. I'm a goddamn video game designer. What do you think of them apples? Or how do you like them apples? I like mine fried. I don't like biting into a whole apple, because my teeth are kind of sensitive, and that's not the most pleasant experience. So, I like fried apples, I like sliced apples. I like using one of those wedging devices where you just push down on the apple and like it cuts the core out and it leaves you with some wedges. Volume 6. No description for what the switch did. Although I cannot re-switch it. Or unswitch it. See, it has like visual elements where they're not helpful. Like, this makes me think that there's something here that I need to do before I progress. I don't know. It's not that big a deal. I mean, like I said, I'm figuring out what to do. I'm not getting stuck for hours, so it does its job. It is totally serviceable level design. So, the three symbols correspond to... I don't know what they correspond to. Oh, it corresponds to the symbol that I saw back there. Okay. Now it makes more sense. So now that I have my... my momentum pack... I'm going to have a lot more options. So whatever the second one I need to do is, that's going to give me the oxygen tank, I assume. And then the last one will open that door. And progress the game. So this one I can probably do with just the momentum tank, right? Or whatever it's called. Turbine pack. I don't know. Let's try it. This is like getting the frog suit in Mario 3. It's a game changer. Alright, so I can actually pop up there, but I can get a little bit of air. Hey, look at that. Using this to breathe underwater, you are now no longer in danger of drowning. Nice. Volume 7. So now all I need is 2 and 3? Yeah, I have 1 through 1 and 4 through 7. I like how it still shows my oxygen level. Oh, so now I need to circle around? Now that I'm not at risk of drowning? Just call me Mixer 100. Like, you don't even have to hold the direction when you're holding the jump button. You just tap the direction you want to go, and you just hold jump. It feels pretty good. Okay, so here is switch number 2. We are making progress. P-R-O-O-G-E-S. That's the way you spell progress. Uh-oh. Silver Grapple has stopped working. A problem caused the program to stop working correctly. Windows will close the program and notify me if a solution is available. Okay, don't worry everyone. I'm sure Windows will tell me what the solution is. Oh, guess not. Oh, dang. I mean, in the past when it crashed, it was very good about just keeping my save at the last checkpoint, so I am not worried about losing progress. Okay, well, I did lose progress, but oh well. I have to get the oxygen tank again. That's a bummer. Get the oxygen tank and flip the other switch. I mean, 2 crashes in what, like, 8 hours of playing the game? That's not bad. Yeah, I'm surprised it doesn't just generate an autosave when I pass the checkpoint. But, oh well. So far, my shortlist for Game of the Year has this game very high up there, and West of Loathing very high up there. Of course, I haven't finished either, but I expect to pretty shortly. I really, really need to play more Trails of Cold Steel. I got distracted from that game by an inferior RPG that won't make my top 10 list. And I think I'm basically at the point where, just to be safe, let's save and quit. So yeah, I'm at the point with... Oh. Well, okay then. So... Oh, I bet only, like, the checkpoints that build up the lights like that? Well, no, because it doesn't do it once you cross it. Or wait, did I make it back? Yeah, I'm not thinking. I was talking about RPGs. So I started playing Operation Abyss Tokyo Legacy. And I enjoyed it. It's a first-person, turn-based dungeon crawler, very anime-inspired, very kind of Etrian Odyssey-like. And I enjoyed it for a while, but it wears out its welcome. And I got bored with it, so I'm probably not going to play that anymore. So I need to get back to Trails of Cold Steel. Which, from what little bit I played, is hopefully very, very good. Hopefully it doesn't wear out its welcome as well. Okay. So I need to get back to the area. Also, this whole area looks like a big old smiley face. Sort of like a Frankenstein smiley face. Like, you have the nose in the middle, these two grates are the eyes, this area is his mouth, and then he has these little head bolts here. So based on my previous theories, I think it's pretty safe to assume that after I go through this door, I will fight Frankenstein. So we have like a giant robot squid boss and a Frankenstein boss. Pretty interesting. I guess I just need to go back through that door. No. Let's see, any other games I play this year that... Oh no, that takes me back here. Okay. I guess I do need to go back to the left. I mean, honestly, Tokyo Abyss might get a spot on my top 10 just because I haven't played that many games. I played about 1 to 2 hours of near automata or automata, and I didn't like that. Let's see, what else? I know there's something I'm forgetting. Oh, Sonic Mania, of course. Sonic Mania is up there. Some really good games this year. Boy, who would have thought 2017, the year a Sonic game makes my top 10 list for a year. We live in interesting times. What? I hit that checkpoint. Okay. Yeah, I think I just need to... I don't need to be in this area at all. I should probably spend more time looking at the big map. Like, I look at my mini map to get a sense of where I am, but the big map would probably be more helpful in this instance. So I need to... Alright, so this big area in the middle is where that panel is. If I could put like a checkpoint on the map, that would help too. It's a little harder to get my bearings on this one because the death areas don't show up, like the red areas. Like if I could see a pattern, then I could probably find what I'm looking for a little bit more easily. I'm glad there hasn't been a super frustrating part in this video yet, except for the one. And it wasn't even super frustrating, it just took a long time. It might have been frustrating to watch. But it's been a lot of like exploration and figuring out new mechanics and puzzle solving. Whoa! Wow. That was fast as hell. It's been a good video, I think. And it's been just about 3 hours now, so I will probably... Okay, so this... So I'm back here now. Yeah, I don't need to be here. This is the mistake I made last... Wait! A thing! I didn't see this before. Floating in a pool of water, you spot a thin book. Volume 3 of the Soaked Journal. Nice. See if I will actually be able to read that book before the end of the stream. Yeah, I'm gonna need a little bit more speed than that, I think. Well, maybe not. I mean, I just need to hop right up there. Okay, so now I'm back here which... Yeah, so... maybe the symbols indicate, like, where the button is relative to where this thing is. So the symbol's on the left, the symbol's on the right, or the symbol's on the right, the symbol's on the left, and the symbol is down below. So, like, I need to get down into this chamber. No, because that's where... Okay. Maybe over here. I'm not sure. I mean, I can swim through this now, no problem. So this is... Right, this is where the first button was. So the only thing... God, that is like a huge... Like, it looks a lot bigger on the map than it actually is, I think. I don't know. Like, it's hard to believe this whole thing was just for the first button. Because it didn't feel like it took that long, but I guess it did. Alright. Well, I think I'm probably just about ready to call it, since I'm still a little perplexed, re my next goal. So if I go... Oh, you know what? That might actually be useful here. I don't know, let's find out. Yeah, this was just the start of the process for the first button, right? Yeah. I don't know. Let's look around a little bit. Like, as soon as I see the pattern on the screen where the spikes are, I'll know I'm in the right place. Or the pattern on the map, I guess. I don't think this is right, though. Shoot! Darn, heck, dang, shoot. Fuck. Yeah, like, the whole thing was just to get the accelerator and flip that switch. And the other thing was to get the oxygen tank and flip the other switch, so now that I have both, I need to flip the final switch. Which is just a matter of figuring out where the F that is. And I've been there. That was the section where I determined I didn't have what I needed to progress. And I just need to find that again, because now I have what I need. Okay, that's... So, okay, so I think I need to go left. because I've been right and I've been down. So the position of the panels doesn't necessarily correspond to where the switch is in relation to the panels. But I can't go left. I mean, this is just a... I mean, unless it's possible for me to build up... Oh yeah, there's a door here. Yeah, if the door showed up on the map, that would be very helpful too. Okay, it has to be this, right? Yeah, there has to be a door over here that leads where I want to go. Right. Okay, so that's what that warning was. That was the warning that, hey, you need both of these things to make it through here. See, I thought the whole thing was part of that Skull Enterprise, you know? I didn't realize at some point that I had circled around. Which I guess is probably a pretty silly thing not to realize. But I'm not the most attentive person in the universe. Actually, I think that chest was just a key or something. I don't think that was one of the objects I needed. Because I would have found it a lot sooner if that was the case. Alright, so I need a good amount of rightwards momentum so I can get back to that warning sign. Because that's where I need both the stuff. And like, I did this like way early. Way prematurely. Alright, so that puts me here, but what do I gain? Like, I can swing this way, and... Like, I can get up here, but that's just the way... Like, this is the way back, right? Yeah, that just takes me back here. So I need to go to the right down here. Unless I need to just somehow keep an unbroken, like, string of momentum. Which, that might be it. Like, so I skate here, I jump, pass through that checkpoint, keep skating, flip myself. No, that doesn't help. Oi. Maybe if I just jump over the center section and keep skating? You suck. Okay. There we go. That's how we do it. Alright. Do not enter unless you are equipped with a turbine pack and an oxygen tank, which I now am. I'm glad I have so many FPS in this game. It would be a pretty nauseating experience otherwise. Okay, I remember this room, yes. Yes. I am on the right track. Yep, I remember this part. And how much of a badass I felt when I got it, like, on, like, the second or third try. Nope. Yeah, okay. Here we go. Yeah, let me complete this segment, and I think I'll call it there. These fans are like with the collision detection and the physics, they're harder to navigate than you would think. Like there, I totally didn't mean to fall off the left-hand side. I was trying to center myself over the fan, and like, this isn't, I mean, it's not like you have to do this all the time, so it's not a big deal. It just circles around. Which means there must have been something that I got there. Like, if it had, like, a little icon showing where I had already obtained an item, that would make all the difference in the world. Right, okay. That doesn't actually help me, but right, okay. I'm so confused. Alright, so that's literally just to get me back up there. I thought I might be able to, like, grapple onto something and swing myself through, but, and, like, get up there or something, but I guess not. Alright, I mean, I just did this, and I must have missed the cue, or whatever. I think there was a door that I should have gone through that I didn't. Yeah, if the door showed up on the map, and if the items you've already gotten show up on the map, then this would be a whole other conversation. I mean, that has to be for an item that I already got, but I don't know. Alright. Maybe it's one of these passages off to the side here. That just takes me back there. That just takes me back here. Alright, so maybe down and left? No, that's just where switch number one was, right? Yeah. Oh wait, no. Is that the switch I need? Holy crap. I think it might be. Right, because I... Okay. So, I... Turns out this is my fault, not the game's. Which, I know it's hard to believe, but... At least I think so? Like, I need to... Like, I need to have enough slack to sort of swing back in the other direction. Which means I need to be further away from this wall. But not so much slack that I hit the floor. Maybe that's not right. I felt like I was onto something. Well, in any case, this is the next switch that I need. Or it's the last switch. Because I had the one by itself. Okay, yep, this is it. This is where I've been trying to get this entire time. With the shiny computer and the... Yep, okay. So, I've been over here. Is there anything worth going over here for? There's like a... So that'll just loop me back around, right? Yeah, it will. Okay. So yeah, I just need to do the thing. Do the thing that I couldn't do before. And Silver Grapple has stopped working. Windows is checking for a solution to the problem. Okay, I am so close now. I'm not going to let this stop me. Let's see how much I have to redo now. Okay, nothing. Well, I mean, except for, you know. Except for this. I'm not about to win the game, Project Fumika, but I will make it to the next section. I mean, I don't really want to stream for like seven or eight hours, or however long it's going to take. I mean, this isn't you have to win the game. You know, I don't have to win the game. I will, eventually, just not on the stream. Alright, so I need... some ski speed. Which means I have to hit this one. And then fleet myself. Nope. Oh, actually... I don't need to do that. Like, I should really think for 5 seconds before I assume things. Because assuming makes an ass out of me. Volume 2 of the Soaked Journal. Okay, I saw that coming. But I can read the entire Soaked Journal now, at least. No work today either. Ugh, I'm so bored. A rat just ran into my office. He's so cute. I'm going to name him Irving Jr. Oh, it ran away. Never mind. It's been almost a week now since the lab was reopened and I was put to work down here. It's gotten pretty lonely. I'm in the middle of preparing the water mains for reopening level 6, with the quarantine finally being lifted, that floor can be put back to good use. All it's done since the accident is store old junky tech. There's been a flooding problem. Water has been rising from the lower level, so I'll just have to do a diagnostic, but I'm pretty sure it's just a blockage in the level 6 pipe. I've turned off the water to stop the damage from getting worse. I found the blockage. Thorned vines have been growing through the pipes. I can't be sure when they started growing, but it could have been at most since the labs were closed. It's going to take a while to poison them all and clean out the pipes. At least I turned off the water when I did. Apparently these vines thrive in water. What little water has been leaked throughout the facility is now filled with these things. They grow really fast. They must have gotten in from the level above. Whatever those idiots were working on, they clearly didn't dispose of it correctly. Disaster. The vines have now broken the pipes to the upper levels too. Water is everywhere. Even my office is flooded. I have no other choice but to swim there and lock the place down. Luckily, we have a couple of oxygen tanks around for cases like this. If all goes to plan, I'll take the teleporter out and find someone to help fix this mess. Okay. So that is some information. I know it's a stool. I want to read the piece of paper above the stool. Level 1 off, level 2 off, level 3 on. The computer's turned off, okay. Off, off, on. Okie doke. So that means the switch is down here? No. The direction I came from. Oh, I know. Yeah, I needed to keep going right there. Like, I thought that would just loop me around, but I forgot that there was a thing I need to do. Okay. But in order to keep going right, I'm going to need more momentum than that. Or I'm going to have to keep my momentum from the speed pad. Alright, so jump, jump, jump. There we go. So if the switch is... Oh, I see. I need to continue right here. Okay. That's doable, question mark? Okay, I see where I messed up. No Perballo. Means a little bit of backtracking is in store. Yeah, there's no way to just float in water. Like, it's either you use the turbine to swim fast in a direction, or you just have normal... Oh, what did you do? Look at what you just did. Aren't you ashamed of yourself? does give me like a little, point there. So maybe I can use that and actually build up more momentum. Although I don't think it's necessary. I don't know. It might be. I'm still not 100% confident that I'm doing the right thing here. So I need to skid or ski down into the right. It means I need to fall off here. Here we go. And then this leads me to the Switch. To the Nintendo Switch. Alright. Dun da 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 dun 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 dun. I don't know. I felt like that deserved a fanfare. So now I just need to get back to where the panels were. Which, that should be relatively simple. I wonder if it would be faster to just teleport back. Nah, it's probably faster to just go through these giant vertical shafts. Nope. Alright, you know what? I am a terrible human, so I think I will just teleport back. I think this will be easier for me than trying to find my way back. Sorry, everyone. I still have the sense of direction of a mushroom. And mushrooms are not very good at figuring out where to go. It's not something that they're well known for. And yes, I know I was just saying I'm glad this game doesn't hold my hand the entire time, and I am. I'm having fun solving these problems and figuring out where to go. I'm just not as good at them as I would like to be. Or I'm not good at doing them live for an audience while talking. Alright, is it through here? I don't think so. Here we go. Alright. Giant Robot Frankenstein, activate. Dun da da da, dun da da da. Oh boy. Where the heck am I now? Okay. Not many people left. Yeah. Oh, Silver Grapple. I was singing your praises about not crashing very much. And then you have to go and start this. Yeah, I wasn't sure if I was boring people. Because no one's really chatting that much. Which, I mean, you don't have to chat. It's not like a requirement. And for anyone watching and not chatting, thank you. I really appreciate you sticking around and watching me be bad at video games. So it's a broken teleporter? Yeah. Or an inactive teleporter. Okay. So I'm going to get whatever this next piece of story is, turn on that teleporter, and then call it. Hey, friend. Ah, I see you've perked back up. I wasn't able to cut Sylvian off. I almost made it, but he closed this blast door in front of me, and I don't have the right card. I failed everyone trapped down here. Thanks to me, we're in more danger than ever. Aw, don't beat yourself up. Use the green key card. Ha! I was hoping I wouldn't have to involve anyone else, but here you are. If you can, please track down Sylvian. Oh, I guess I never told you much about him. Sylvian has stolen a quarantined item, a very dangerous one. If he leaves this laboratory with it, it will be identified as a breach in quarantine. If this happens, a last resort protocol will be put into effect. The self-destruction of this laboratory. Good luck. Alright. So, that will do it for this session of Silver Grapple. Ouch, ah. So, next episode we chase after Sylvian and try to prevent the destruction of us and everyone we love. So, tune in then. Don't know when the next stream will be, but watch the usual places for updates. Twitter, Facebook, Steam group, as always, is the best way to get notifications. Sounds like endgame. I mean, it's definitely close. I still have 3 more teleporters to activate, though. This is one of them. So maybe after I catch Sylvian, there will be some other revelation. And there's still a pretty good bit of the map that doesn't have anything in it. Oh, it's only us. Okay, well, thanks for sticking around, Project Fumika. And thank you, Tarka, and Optimus Prime Optimus, and Levant. Thank you all so much for coming and hanging out. I really appreciate it. Thanks to everyone watching on YouTube. And yeah, keep watching the skis. Goodbye.